Hey everyone, thanks for tuning in today to our video on software engineering resumes. We'll be discussing tips and tricks on how to best apply for the role you want, whether that's at Miro or anywhere else. At the end of the video, we're also going to dive into some examples to put our tips into practice.
Welcome to the Life at Miro YouTube channel. Let's get started. Hi, I'm Alyssa, and I'm a technical sourcer for engineering.
I'm Rico. I'm a senior technical recruiter here at Miro.
The first thing I'd like to talk about is there's this great debate of only one or multiple pages. And Rico, what is your thought on that?
Yeah, so of course, if you have multiple years of experience, it doesn't really make sense to try and cram everything in one page. If you have that experience, it's okay. I know we don't spend a lot of time going through every little bit of the resume, but still, you know, trying to get all of that experience into one page, don't. Just spread it out a little bit. Two pages is fine. Just don't make it an entire book.
And going off of that, recruiters look at CVs on an average of 6 to 7 seconds. We at Miro, there's no machine or kind of ATS system that we're using. Each recruiter is reviewing your CV personally. And so when you have a resume with maybe 2 or 3 pages, it can be difficult to grasp the context of what's on the page just at a first glance.
Usually the basic outline is quite fast to read. And then when something is really grasping the attention, just all the basics, you know, location, what tech stack, some of the experience that we can see, that makes us read further. And then, of course, we'll spend a little bit more than just 7 seconds. But still, that's kind of the first time span we need to kind of already see, okay, looks like it's not particularly relevant for this role and we'd have to go to the next one. Because, yeah, do imagine that we have like 200 plus applications at a time. We can go 5 or more minutes with every one of them.
Yeah.
Or we won't even get to talk to you at all.
And so what we're going to dive a little bit deeper into is kind of the structure of what it should look like. So as we mentioned, each recruiter is reviewing each CV personally. So you want to make sure that your structure is clean, readable, just like your code might be.
You know, engineering and recruitment actually has some kind of similarities, we would say, in that sense. You know, if you give dirty code to a machine, then it won't be able to read it. Same for, us as recruiters with a CV or with a resume. So in that sense, make it clean. That will really help. Yeah, so some of the things to look out for in structure, just basic layout. Often we do see education is put first, while afterwards you actually have plenty of years of experience. So yeah. Don't do that. Put your work experience first, only education later. Of course, the basic details from your name to maybe the location of where you are at that point in time, that will help. But no need for like a full address. No need for a picture, just distracts. Basically, the skills should basically explain their own story. Tech stack is relevant. We do check for that as well. So put it in the skills, but don't make an entire summary of all of the things you've ever worked on, even if it was for like a day or so. Just focus on the strong ones, the ones you're most comfortable with, and add those in.
And for every job under your experience, you should have the title of the company, your title, and basically how long you were there for. Some of the things that we're using to check are, okay, what other companies have you worked at? What was your title? Here we can gain seniority or a level of seniority. And also what your tenure is like. Tenure means basically how long you've stayed at a company. And for each kind of area of experience, it should have this section. So company title, job title, and amount of time you were there.
Yeah, maybe to add to that, no need to put like 1.2 years of experience at that particular role. Also, don't list just the year, 2019 to 2021. That can basically be 1 year or two. It does help to at least specify by month. So for yeah. example, I have one in front of me, 8/21 to present, then of course we know that you're there for quite a while already.
Another thing is you'll want to clearly list out your responsibilities or any projects that you've worked on at the company. Personally, I would say no more than 4 or 5 bullet points. And you'll want to use words like I drove or I executed or things that have a better indication of what you as an employee did rather than the team, or we as a team did this. We want to know more about you and what kind of initiative you take.
Yeah, common mistake that we do see, you know, every other day happening is like making a summary of all of the bullet points, basically in a long list rather than just listing it at the actual experience where you've had this. For us, it's better to know what impact you made in what company at a certain period of time, rather than listing in everything, because 12 years ago it made less sense than it makes right now for the next role you want to go for.
Another thing you're going to want to think about is adding bullet points that talk about the impact that you've had at the company. So you'll want to add metrics. So for example, I was working on a landing page and it led to 25% more conversion, something like this, where we can clearly see the metrics, the impact, and what you did. Some things that we see quite often that are not necessarily the most helpful are kind of the skills percentage bars. For us, this doesn't tell us anything. It tells us maybe that you vaguely know a language, but we want to know what you are strongest at and what you feel that you could go in right away and work with.
Yes, and usually those percentages only work in context, right? So what bar are you measuring yourself against? Is it you yourself? You feel that you have a 75% understanding of Java, but then a new library comes out and where you're then, right? So those percentages don't really help. Just listing that you're there and you've been actively working with it for a couple of years, that makes way more sense. On that note, it's also good within your resume. Of course, we've been talking about impact and adding bullet points. It's also okay to leave a little bit out that you can still share in a recruiter screen or further down the line in the process to still have something more to talk about than just everything there. Mm-hmm. And it might help with cramming one thing on one page.
Another point we'd like to touch on is maybe it's best to leave some of the personal details out of your CV. And what we mean by this is we don't necessarily need to see that you're interested in sports or baking pies or something like this. I would say that's a little bit more appropriate for LinkedIn, where you can share a lot, all of the context that you need.
We've done a lot of talking. Maybe it's also good to kind of show what we actually do, what we see when we're going into a resume. So we have some examples. I have to mention they are templated ones, so they aren't actually real persons. That would violate GDPR. So that's not something we want to do. But we'll definitely dive into some and then kind of highlight. You'll be able to see the screen.
First, we're going to start with a not-so-perfect example. So I'm seeing a lot of things here. Namely, I'm seeing that the education is going first, whereas we would like to see the work experience go first. As we mentioned already, we have a limited time to kind of grasp the context of what's in your CV. So it's good to have the work experience first. And Rico, what else are you seeing?
Well, clearly we talked about the percentage, or sometimes it's a percentage or just a bar that we can see here below. Coding and debugging, I don't know if this is a 4 out of 5, an 8 out of 10, but it doesn't really say a lot. Yes. If you're this good in technical documentation, what are you basing that on? So it's rather to omit this part and either put it in bulleted content or just omit it altogether.
And it also doesn't give me a lot of confidence that we could put you in a debugging situation, which you will be in quite often. In these cases, it's best to leave them out if you're not fully content with your skill set, and only add the ones that you feel are going to be the best for you.
Yeah, maybe one more point. This is great, you know, football player, sports, but January 2022. So you did one training, doesn't really add something to basically your skills. And we're also not hiring football players in this case, so.
Yeah, so it's basically taking up an entire section where you could talk a little bit more about the impact you've had in your role. And lastly, at the bottom, I'm seeing kind of technical. To me, it looks a little bit buzzwordy. I'm seeing JavaScript, Node.js. I'm not seeing any cloud providers that you've worked it with. Here, additionally, we see technical documentation, but we're not seeing kind of what tools you've used. So you want to make sure that what is on your CV is telling us a very clear and structured story.
Yeah, and if we add one last thing for this one before we show a good example, also here, we just spoke about adding months. So 2019 to 2020, that can be from December to January. Yeah. or it can be from January till December for both years. It doesn't give enough context to give us confidence that you have been in certain roles for a certain amount of time, really knowing that you have been able to create impact. We know that in 2 months, it's very hard to create impact. In 2 years, there's a ton you can do.
Exactly.
So now we're gonna look at a much better example. And Rico, why don't you tell us kind of what you're seeing just from the beginning?
Yeah, so something we actually didn't cover before, but it's something good to note here at the top. It says Bay Area, California, which is great. It doesn't give a full address. We don't need a full address. It just has a location. That makes sense for us because we also relocate from different parts of the world. So for us, it's clear to see, hey, we should relocate this person, yes or no. And it just adds, you know, a checkbox to our practicalities section.
Here we can very clearly see the first and last name. We have the contact details here, and this is a really good way to start. In this section, it's not extremely long. It's a very brief summary of who you are as an engineer. This section is player's choice, so either you can leave it in or you can leave it out, but think about kind of what you want to add to your impact sections.
If we move to experience just down here, that's the first thing that really catches the eye. So it's also in bold, at least the titles are there, so that really makes sense. You have the professional experience, you have the last first, and then going back in time, basically up until the start, where here it was front-end developer in New York from 2012. I would add months here to have some improvement point, because again, that of course says a lot. But in this case, we can already see here that it really was multiple years. Now here there's at least like three or four, same here. And since it's 2023 now, same goes for the last experience. So there's plenty of experience there, and then maybe you want to dive into the bulleted content.
Yeah, great. But before I do that, I just want to show a very clear example. Here you can see the name of the company, and you can very clearly see the title. This is a really good example. In the bullet points here, again, this is a templated CV, so we're not going to do a super deep dive, but off the top, I can see very clearly here that there's a metric. So increased conversion rates by 15%. That's a really good example of what we were discussing earlier, how we want to see your impact. And then again, there are three to five bullet points for each area. It's clear, it's readable, I can see exactly what I need. And it tells a very clear story.
Not everything is perfect, though. If we look at education, sometimes we do look at it. If, you know, it's already 12 years ago, it's
less
definitely
relevant.
Less relevant. Yes. Yeah. But here it is good to add, you know, it just says 2012. If you would add it was from 2008 to 2012, it really is a difference if you basically were in the university for 10 years, didn't finish, or you were just there for, you know, the curriculum of time, which is 4 years, 5 years. Can be a little bit longer. It doesn't have to be perfect, but, you know, 10 or four, that's definitely a difference.
Another thing is, again, adding education is player's choice. We're now moving into a time where education is not always kind of indicative of experience. And so if you feel it is kind of helping you tell your story, you can add it. But if you want to leave it out, you can also leave it out. And then at the bottom, we'll go to the last section, which is skills. In comparison to the other one, you can see there's a lot more context here. What are you seeing, Rico?
True, although it is limited, I would say. Like, it's not too clear on most relevant skills. It also just kind of tries to cram everything in one page, which we tried to explain is not especially necessary. So for example, the skills which are clearly tech related, but then volunteering is also there, kind of distracts a little bit. This is very detailed, of course, but still, that could use some work.
Point of improvement would be removing the education section here and adding your tech stack or kind of what tools you work with on a day-to-day basis. That way we can very clearly see the experience, we can see the tech stack, and then go from there.
One final one. So you'll see some of the same words here, to be honest, I think, especially the first one. Here, the highlights are also really quite clear. Work experience first, last experience first, company where someone has worked in bold, and then really have a clear indication of what the title was, followed by bulleted content on what impact was made. Everything on the right side is also really clear. You know, in the last resume, we've seen that final piece on tech skills, that's not in the best place. If you're talking about us scanning for Java and it's really on the bottom of the page, doesn't really help quickly seeing that in the 6 to 7 seconds. Here we can definitely see on the right side, boom, skills, Groovy Pearl, anything that goes under there. That's a very quick scan for us, knowing if it's relevant to go deeper into this resume or not.
Yes, I agree. And we're not saying that you need to use this exact structure, but what we are saying is that the experience is clear, the skill set is clear, and your contact information is clear. One other point I'd like to use is here at the bottom. You see, this person has shortened their experience, because we can see, okay, yes, you are extremely experienced, but we don't need to know what you did 20 years ago.
And if that matches, of course, the job we're at that moment looking for, then yes, we would advance, invite you to a recruiter screen and start the process from there.
Yes. Again, when we're discussing the content of the bullet points, you can always feel free to tailor your experience to the job that you're applying for. So let's say, for example, this role that you're going for is for a senior software engineer in infrastructure. You want to make sure that your bullet points clearly highlight like any projects or initiatives that you worked on that have to deal with infrastructure and that are clearly like indicative that you are a senior. What do you think, Rico?
Same. The bulleted content, yes, as long as you have actually worked on these type of projects, right? Don't try to change anything really in terms of omitting and then creating gaps in your resume. If you had a couple of interesting companies, but one is less relevant for the role, that's okay. You know, you make changes, everybody makes pivots in their career. Don't omit the bigger parts, but you can really tailor that bulleted content to make a bit more sense for the job you're applying for and what particular area of the business this role is.
Another thing that Rico and I would like to touch on is, should you apply for a job that you are maybe not 100% qualified for? What are your thoughts on this, Rico? I'm very curious.
Nice way to pass it over, but yes. Yes, depends. Of course, there's a job description, but we don't expect everyone to fully fit the ideal profile that we have. Look, of course, at what are relevant languages. Some, usually the top first 1, 2, and 3, those are kind of the hard criteria. So if you don't match those, likely you're not going to get through all the way to a recruiter screen. The ones that are on the bottom, and maybe there's like 5, 6, or even 7 bullet points of a job description, those might be in order of importance.
Yeah.
So then if you don't fully qualify for the last ones, that's fine. Still apply. Try to kind of look for the hard requirements. If you match those, it's fine to apply.
An area where we can be a bit flexible is years of seniority. So let's say the job description is calling for 6 years, but you have 5. I would say that's very borderline. Let's apply.
Especially nowadays, we know that the years of experience don't always are the very best indication of what level you are in the organization. Sometimes people with 5 years, they had such opportunities that they grew faster than others. But others who are there for 15 years in the same company, they haven't had that type of growth. So for us, we also look at that not as strictly as you might think.
So that brings us to the end of today's video.
If you found this useful, let us know in the comments, like our video, subscribe to our channel, and we hope to see you in the next one.